Welcome, everyone. My name is Mike Orlowski. I am the dubbing stage engineer for Full Sail University. Welcome to our panel today about breaking into the audio industry. Let me introduce Frank Scheuring, David Farmer, Gary Rizzo, and Marc Fishman. So in thinking of, we've had this talk so many times in my career at Full Sail of how to break into the business, how do we get our first job, how do we get an internship. And I thought with post-production, the most unique thing about post-production that I love is we always have the ability to stop, go back, and do another pass. And what we've learned from that other pass makes that pass hopefully better. So I'm going to start kind of from the beginning with all of you guys, and I want you to go back to orientation. Like, if this was your very first day of school, knowing what you know now, and we're going to go down the line, starting with you, Frank, what would you do on day one?
Start at that end?
No.
Nice try.
Wow. That's really difficult. Everything's so different on campus and in the world in general right now compared to my first day. So what would I do? I think I would seek out the people in my class, in my month, that looked like they were going to be the ones that were going to work their butts off. Mm-hmm. And try to get them in my lab group.
Right.
You know, so that I had other people that had the same motivation as me, you know, to help push me harder than I would have pushed myself.
Okay. David?
That's a great answer, Frank.
Thank you. I think, you know, when you get out into the industry, I think the first cold reality you are faced with is, I'm not surrounded by teachers anymore. I'm surrounded by people that are trying to get their job done today. And some of these people also see you as competition for their jobs. So what you find is, you know, you have an environment here where people's jobs are to teach you. And I think what you need to make sure you do your entire stay here is to get your money's worth out of the teachers and out of the labs and out of every single nugget of information you can learn here, because that's what this place is for. When you get out, people don't have time to teach you anymore. Occasionally you'll come across a nice mentor like Harry that can take the time to, and will take the time to show you the ropes. But you need to set a goal right now. I don't know how, you know, what stages of your tenure here you're all in, but you need to make sure you maximize your time with the teachers and drive them. I think when I look back on my year here, I think that was one of the things I was actually most proud of that I actually did. I think this is a little douchey of me to say, but on my first day here, John Phelps came through our classrooms and he went one by one to each one of us and said, you know, introduced who we were and stuff. I said, and why are you here? And I was kind of nervous to say this, but I stood up and I just said, you know, I'm David Farmer, I want to be a sound designer and I want to be the best, that's why I'm here. And I felt a little strange saying that, but it sort of set the bar for me and let my classmates know. It's like, I'm serious here, you know, I'm here to get everything I can out of it, and if you want to join me, let's team up. And your point, Frank, I think was excellent, is find the people that are also serious around you, because you will learn from each other. And these are people that you may wind up working with in the real world once you get out as well.
Gary.
First of all, I agree with both you guys. Those are excellent answers. If I could really sum it down into one word, I would say listen. Listen to everybody. Listen to everything that's going on around you. Listen to your teachers and the wisdom that they have to share, and listen to your peers, because they probably have some experiences that you may not have had that you can learn from. Listen to music. because there are things to learn from that listen to movies, listen to the things that are all around you, because listening is a real-time event, and we live in a non-linear world where everybody wants to do things faster than ever, you know, and half the time that it took us yesterday to do it is how long it takes us today. But listening is one of those things that you have to do in real time. So I would say embrace that. Don't be in a hurry. Take the time to listen to everything around you, because there's a lot to learn by listening. I think that goes for personal relationships as well as professional relationships. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah. I don't agree with any of you.
I'm just kidding. No, I mean, I think I think the one thing that I would have focused on differently from day one, if I could go back and do it again, is I was so focused and so I worked so hard when I was here, but I didn't work on socializing and I mean socializing with my classmates and going out and learning people, because in post-production, music can be a little different when you're working on a project. It might be an engineer and the producer and a couple people. But on a film team, you have between 15, 20, 30, 40 people on every show. You come in and out of these families, and I think I would have made more time to learn how to do that better instead of just being so focused, because that's, you know, you get better at your job because of the people that you work with, and you strive to be better and to do that stuff. And I think that's what I would have worked on a little bit better, because without fail, when I meet graduates and they come out, you know, the shyness is what kills them usually, and it's the ability, you know, you guys have worked hard, you sacrificed, and that says enough about you that you want to be there. So it's not about cockiness, and it's not about saying I deserve this, but it's understanding that you've started to put forth the effort that you do deserve to be there and that you can be part of the team, and to not act like, you know, oh my God, I can't believe this is happening. You know, you'll fit in, so.
If I may say so, yeah. I think you've probably passed your social awkwardness, Mark. I think you've learned that lesson quite well.
Thank you, David.
Well, before we jump into more questions with the panel, we have a special guest video that I would like to play. So let's look at the screen.
Let's go to the clip. I wish I could be there on the sound panel, because you have good people on the panel. And since I can't be there, I'll give you my 2 cents. You're going into the world of post, coming from school. You know technology. You've studied all the technology there is out there right now. I'm sure you know it better than I do. That's going to get you a job, make your resume, say, I can operate all this stuff. I know this piece of equipment, this piece of equipment. It'll get you a job. Once you get a job, let the technology recede and make the heart of your job storytelling. Make everything you think about when you use the technology, make it all about telling a story, creating a mood, creating an emotion. If you do that, you're going to do great, just like the people on the panel. Wish I was there. Have a wonderful panel discussion.
I love that man.
Yeah.
He's fantastic.
I don't know where we go from there. We should.
I think we should go. Gary Reichman.
Is that considered a Gary Reichman photobomb?
Yes.
Maybe?
I think so.
Video bomb.
So, say you've gone through most of your classes, you're getting towards the end of graduation, you got maybe like a couple months left. I want you to go back to that point. I mean, it's been a long time for you guys, I know. But as you're getting almost, you know, maybe senioritis is kind of creeping in a little bit, you know, you want to get out there, but you still have a couple more months to go. I want to speak about that. Tell me, you know, what you were thinking, you know, getting ready to call these companies. You know, do you want to call them too soon? Do you want to have a game plan together? Do you want several places that you're going to go to? Like, what's going in your mind, you know, back then?
Well, if I was to do it again, I'd do it exactly like I did before. And what I did was, a few months before graduation, there was a break. I think it was Easter or I don't know, some break where I had time to go home. And I made a bunch of phone calls, set up some interviews, took care of that, talked to all these places and said, all right, this is the place I want to work at. And what do I have to do to get there? And I spent the last several months of my time here learning other stuff just so I could get in the door. You know, not audio stuff, and it worked. So, you know, I think, yeah, I don't know that there's a too soon that you can reach out to the facilities or studios or whoever, production companies, because then you can always reach out to them again later, you know, and just continue that communication. So I don't think there's a too soon.
Okay.
And I would say definitely reach out to a number of places so that way you can kind of feel it out and see which one you will fit better in, you know.
When I was about this stage of my time here, I don't know what it was. It was youthful arrogance and I was so focused on where I wanted to be. I knew I wanted to be at this company called EFX, where Mark already was. And I wanted to be there because they had synclaviers. That's why I came to Full Sail, because they had synclaviers, and I wanted to learn about synclaviers. And I saw that I looked up in the magazines and saw that EFX had more synclaviers than anybody else. And they were doing movies, and I'm like, that's where I want to go. And I was a lot of people tried to talk me out of that, because EFX had a tendency to take on interns, but use them up. And that's what a lot of people do, you know, when you find internships. People, the entertainment industry is made on the blood of the willing, that are people that are willing to come out and sacrifice themselves and give everything they've got, and the industry just turns them out. Because it's a business. Don't forget that, all right? It's a creative, but it's a business, and people have to make the bottom line. And there's lots of people coming out. So they know they've got, you know, supply and demand. They know they've got lots of people they can use up for these things. But I was so focused on wanting to wind up at this company that I just didn't listen to anything anybody had to say, and trying to talk me out of it. It was like, that's where I'm going, and I don't know why I felt like it was going to happen, but I sort of knew that I was going to wind up there, and I did call and set up some interviews with a few other places. I flew out to Burbank about a month before I graduated, interviewed at EFX. The first place I went was EFX for an interview. They said they would take me, and I didn't even go to the other places I had scheduled to go to interviews to.
You stood up for your interview?
Well, yeah.
Wow.
And the other thing I did was, in this interview where I was there, when you find your way into the industry, you wind up getting pigeonholed into almost whatever you start at. It's very hard to change tracks. You know, once you're on this path, you it's very difficult. People think, oh, well, I'll go do sound effects for a while, then I'll start mixing. It doesn't quite work that way. The other way around, too, if you start mixing, you don't wind up editing. So when I went in, they had a need for dialogue editors. So Pat Johnston, the guy that was interviewing me, said, how do you feel about dialogue? I was like, I love it. Inside, I'm going, no way in hell I'm ever doing dialogue. I'm a sound effects guy. I'm not doing dialogue. But I told him that's what I would do. And then and he told me later that the enthusiasm I had in the interview, he said, and he told me this thing that I didn't even know I was doing, but I was sitting on the edge of my chair, like just leaning forward, just listening to everything he had to say. And he said that the enthusiasm I had in that interview was the reason that they decided, no, I would be a candidate they would take. And I graduated and flew out, and that was just sort of, the path that I took. It was the best decision I ever made doing that. And now that we have Juan coming on, there's four of us, the three of us, and Juan that also went through EFX. So, I don't know, you gotta balance it. I mean, there's when you get out of here, you might think you know everything there is to know. And I thought, when I graduated, I thought, I'm ready to design a film. I could sit down in front of a synclavier and I could do the whole thing. And the first day I sat in there, I was just like, ooh, this is not, I'm not ready for this yet. So you gotta be willing to listen to the people that are doing it. Sorry, I kind of segued a little bit there, but.
I think it's funny that you say, you know, try to remember a few months before you graduated and how you were feeling, and it was a long time ago. Yeah. Indeed, it was a long time ago, but I was so scared. I remember so clearly how I felt, because I was scared to death. I thought, how am I ever going to get started? How am I ever going to make an impression on anybody? And at the time, the career development department was called the placement department. And I was working with Tammy and she actually had suggested EFX based on the fantastic history that Full Sail graduates had with EFX, David being a, and Mark being prime examples of that. And for me, I actually wanted to work for the Walt Disney Studios in their audio department. And EFX was down the street. So I thought, okay, well, you know, maybe this is a stepping stone. Maybe this is just a way to get started. I actually did interview at Disney as well as at EFX, but Disney was a union shop. They basically said, go away, little boy. You don't really have any experience. We can't bring you in here. So I saw EFX as a huge opportunity to get in, and they took me on as an unpaid intern for, I don't remember how long it was, 2 months, 3 months. And for me, I just thought, this is it. This is the only opportunity you're gonna get to make an impression. And I killed myself. If anybody knows anything about me, I'm an extremist. So when they said, yeah, you can come in and you can be an intern and you'll start by sitting in with some of our editors. David was one of those people that I sat in with. I'm pretty sure you were cutting backgrounds on like Renegade, this USA Network TV show from 20 plus years ago. And I watched and I listened and I absorbed. And then when I wasn't there doing that, I was trying to do other things around the studio that would be helpful enough that people wouldn't be upset that I took it upon myself to do it, but thankful that I had done it, like just taking something off their plate. And that's when I started to make friends, and that was how it went. I don't know if I would change my trajectory. I think I'm pretty happy with the way it worked out. So,
how about you, Mark?
I mean, I think, you know, when I was here, it was only a 10-month program, so it was a little different. About two months out, I started thinking about what I wanted to do and knew about EFX and started calling them and stuff. And I think if there's anything I can say, if there's a piece of advice, it's to pick up the phone and call. If you want to, you see a studio and you go, okay, I want to do that, pick up the phone and call and say, can I talk to so-and-so? It's not... There's not this magic vaulted gate that, you know, doesn't unlock. The receptionist will say, yeah, or can I take a message?
It's a great point. People are accessible. You shouldn't be afraid to at least reach out.
Yeah, and I think that's the biggest thing I find is people, you take the call and they're like surprised and they're like, why are you, like you're somebody that likes film and you want to be in the business, and that's a like-minded person to me. And so that's obviously somebody I'm going to want to talk to. And you know, David talked about being flexible, and there was a Full Sail grad, Jeff, who came out about a year and a half ago to LA, had a real hard time for the first 5 or 6 months, but took an internship. Last June started. They killed him for about 3 months. And then one day, and he wants to be a re-recording mixer. And they said, can we show you the ADR stage? And he went on the ADR stage and spent a day and a half being trained. And then they said, we have an ADR session tomorrow. And about 4 weeks later, he ended up being the sole ADR mixer on the Hercules movie that just came out and shot everything. And then about 2 weeks ago, they finally said, oh, well, why don't you come in and watch us do some background pre-dubs and maybe we can get on that. So about being flexible, because the fact of the matter is I was an editor before I became a mixer, and I'm a much better mixer because of it, because I learned all those other different things. And same with Gary and everybody. I mean, we had all these different experiences, so it all helps.
Yeah, I had a student come to me probably 4 or 5 months ago. He says, I want to work at Skywalker. And my first question to them is, have you applied to the LucasArts page for the internship? No, I haven't. Have you called Skywalker to alert them, to let them know that one day you're coming to be an intern? And he said, no. And I said, well, I have some very bad news for you. And he's like, what? I said, you don't want to work at Skywalker. And I gave a challenge to all of my interns on the dub stage. I said, by Friday, I want you to find Skywalker's number. And I have no idea how they did it. I don't know Skywalker's number. It's not published. But they found the number, and they all called, and they wanted to speak to Randy Tom, who's the director of sound service. And so they pick up the phone, call Skywalker. They don't let you know. They don't say, hello, Skywalker. They just, you know, I think a couple of my interns just said, studio. They picked up the phone, and he was like, may I speak to Randy Tom, please? And they heard, hold. And then, this is Randy. And then, at that point, go. Start talking. And I wanted to ask you guys, I mean, Really, has there been ever a challenge of you ever being able to talk to someone that you wanted to talk to someone? You might have been afraid to do it as a student, but like when it really came down to it, was it ever difficult to get any of your mentors on the phone, you know, on the, maybe not on the first try, but.
Well, let me chime in too, though. I've never had that problem. I mean, I don't think there's anybody that's never not taken the call, but the other thing is we talk about these phone calls. I still have to call directors cold or producers. I want to work on your movie. I want to do this. And so we talk about skill sets and stuff. It's still, I sometimes you get nervous and you go, oh my gosh, I don't want to call, you know, you get this. But I mean, it is a really good point, Mike, that it's not, I mean, you're not trying to call Barack Obama, you know. There is an accessibility, and there's never been anybody that's just said absolutely not. Sometimes people are hard to get in touch with. Sometimes it takes them a month to get back to you, but I've never had anybody that has not reached back out or said, no, you know, who are you, or I'm not going to talk to you.
The nice thing, though, with what you're talking about, Mike, is that you're teaching them confidence. Mm-hmm. That's something that experience alone really, that's the source of the confidence. I think it's fantastic that you give them that challenge by Friday, do this. Like, that's great. Yeah. A lot of times it takes a long time for people to have that self-confidence to be able to make that bold move. But
so I had a, in preparing for this, I had a talk with one of our online instructors. He brought up a fantastic question because we have a lot of students who are online watching us right now. And you guys were all campus students. Interacted with each other, not each other, but other students on campus. But what would you want to say to an online student that's doing everything that our students are doing here, but on their computer, on their own, you know, where
back,
do they go from
there? Back up your data.
Back up your data.
Yeah, sure.
What do you think, David?
How would you encourage them?
Well, that's a really hard question.
I know.
I'm trying to think of what you know, the difference is. I mean, Mark talked about the social aspect of the business. If you're working on your computer at home, doing an online course, I guess it's tough to get the personal interaction that you would get in a classroom. So I'm trying to figure out how you might bridge that gap. Do you guys have any thoughts?
Well, I think, I mean, once again, you talk about getting around like-minded people, so it's a little different day and age where you can find people online. You can join, you know, forums that are hobbyist forums, or you can, there's, you know, I know every city has, like, home theater meetups, and that might be a way to meet people who like film and stuff. I'm sure there's some way to reach out to other Full Sail on-campus people through the web portal and stuff, so I would do that.
I would encourage collaboration, is what I would do. I know, you know, students may be taking courses and getting their degrees online, but I would still encourage the reaching out and joining a community, because I have to say, at least for the mix, it is a collaboration or it is nothing. You know, you are interfacing with people eye to eye. You know, it's happening in real time. It's happening in front of us. We do it together on that dub stage. It's not a feat that any one person pulls off. It's definitely a team effort.
I probably sidetracked a little bit by going down the social route, because that's only one aspect of the business. But the great thing, I think, the super positive thing about having an online course and being an online student is that the technology to do what we do now, I didn't have that possibility when I was going here. You know, I mean, there was no such thing as a DAW, you know. I mean, except for maybe New England Digital, which was like $100,000 for 8 tracks of disc-to-disc recording. But now you've got Pro Tools, Nuendo, all these things that you can get for pretty cheap. The tools that you can use at home, I work at home, you know, most of the time. And you got access to the same tools I do. And I actually try to work on the cheap as much as I can, not because it's cheap, but because I like to see what the tools are that are out there. I mean, when I just went over to New Zealand and did Hobbit 2, I bought this little Motu ultralight interface, and that's what I took over. It's just a bus-powered interface. I bought it. It's like the first generation Motu thing. It cost me $200, you know, FireWire powered. That's what I used. on Desolation of Smaug. You know, everything I was monitoring was through this little box. You know, you don't have to have the Omni and Pro Tools HD and all these things, and it's all great if you can, but you don't have to have that. Nobody can hear the movie and say, oh, you did that on an ultralight, because all I'm doing, that's just the output.
Right.
I'm monitoring it. And
right. You're being hired for your perspective.
Yeah.
And your taste.
Yeah.
And your experience. The tools nowadays are, you know, it's more about how you use the tools and what you like and what you don't like and how you bring it out. And David's the best.
Well, the getting your chops up is so important. I mean, and when we went through, as far as editing, you know, when we started our jobs, it was difficult to get time to edit because the rooms were always busy. The rooms were being booked day and night. EFX was a place that had day shifts and night shifts. So trying to get access to the tools to practice was, you know, really hard to come by. But now you've got the stuff, the same tools you're using in the studio, you can have at home for pennies, sort of, you know? So you can actually practice and get your chops up. And I would recommend that everybody that's at home practice, you know, grab a scene from your favorite film. And if you're trying to do sound design for a film, grab a scene. Reverse engineer it. Try to figure out how they did that, because that's how I learned most of what I do, is copying people like Gary Rydstrom, you know, is loading in a movie, Jurassic Park, you know, Backdraft, all these things, Star Wars, loading in a scene and trying to copy it, trying to do what they did, you know, trying to replicate the speeder bike chase, trying to do the T-Rex roar. I'm still trying to do something as good as a T-Rex roar. Nothing will ever beat it. But you know, you learn so many tricks. It's just like Harry Cohen used to tell me. He's like, he used to come and watch me doing this. Like, I have an explosion and I'm trying to match the explosion, trying to figure out what was done. He's like, it's like you're learning licks off a record, you know, a guitar lick, you know, Eddie Van Halen. You're trying to copy. You listen to Eruption. You slow it down. You listen. You practice. So I would suggest practice your butts off with the tools that you have at home.
I'm going to go back to the networking thing. And it goes for online and on-campus students. You have a lot of opportunities to network, not only with your classmates, but with guys like these. Like, and I'll give you an example. So, and Dave kind of laughs at me about this, but I didn't know these guys. Well, I knew Mark, but I didn't know Gary and Dave, right? So I sent him a friend request on Facebook, because what's the worst thing that can happen? Decline, right? And then I got to know them on that, you know, and you develop a relationship, you know what I mean? So it doesn't matter if you know the person or not. If you know of them and they are someone that you can learn from or you know, something like that, then reach out in any way you can. Facebook, Twitter, phone call, whatever, email, it doesn't matter. And just reach out and try to develop a relationship so you can learn.
One thing I would add to that is one of the things I've been fortunate from having them as Facebook friends, and as we've been preparing for the Hall of Fame this past couple of weeks, and there's been a thread of everybody chiming in and getting together of like, where are you going to be or what are you going to be at this time? And it made me think of something that I've been telling my interns about is, when you do talk to these guys, when you finally get the opportunity or whoever your mentor is going to be, I think bottom line, you got to realize that they're an ordinary person. Most of us have families. We have kids. We have things that we like to do other than our work. And just realize that we're just a normal guy, a person that you can come up to and talk and just say, you know, how's your day going? You know, those things still matter. It's not just so I had this plug-in the other day and I want that's not what's going to get them excited to talk to you again and again and again. Being personable, you know, realizing that, you know, I'm not into sports, but I know that they're into baseball because I see what's going on their Facebook. So if I wanted to, I could talk to them about that. The next step that I wanted to bring up with you guys is, you graduated, you passed the interview, you're actually on the stage, you know, you're with a client or you're around where there are clients. You know, what are the do's and don'ts? What are funny stories that you can tell of like, that's not a good thing, and you know, what are stories that are positive. And one that I have that was just completely random is we had one of the guys setting up for the stage, setting up the cheese and cracker plates, and he went to the store and he got Nilla wafers and creamy peanut butter. And he was going around and he put the peanut butter in the jar and he was putting these Nilla wafers. And I remember everybody in the client services going like, what are you doing? It's like a really, not, you know, it's a big client today. And he's just like, I know. And it's just like, but Nilla wafers, really? And he puts it out on the stage and the client comes and grabs the knife and puts a little bit of peanut butter on Nilla wafer and takes a bite of it. And it's like the Ratatouille moment where he goes back to being a child. He was just so happy. And for like the rest of the day, it was just like the best mix ever. And it was because of Nilla wafers. So I give it to the panel.
So what do you do? Well, I mean, you work your butt off and you do anything and everything that you can. Going the funny story route, when I was, I don't know, 8 or 10 months in at MVI Post, where I started and I was there for 12 years, I did anything and everything that they wanted me to do. It didn't matter. And so one time I was taking the trash out of the kitchen, and I don't remember why there was trash in the middle of the day, but I was taking it out, and one of the clients showed up as I was carrying the bag of trash to the dumpster, and she's walked in the front door. And I found this out much later. I was supposed to do a session with her the next day, and she didn't want to work with me because I must not have been that good at what I did because I was taking the trash out, right? And this, it turns to a positive story. So then my boss said, okay, fine, I'll do the session. She wasn't even there supervising, so I did the session. And then after, she came in for mix review, and he said, oh, by the way, Frank did this. And then I did every show for her for 2 or 3 years before she went to another job. So, perception, my point is, you might perceive something, or someone else might perceive something you do as, good or bad or whatever, but the person that you're need to worry about, A, client, and B, your boss, right? So in that case, I was doing what my boss wanted, and it worked out, so.
Good, it did indeed. When I started my internship, I was kind of terrified. I mean, I was sort of gutsy and I guess confident about that, how I thought things were going to work out, but I was terrified because I had been taught that, when you're in a studio environment, you don't talk, that artists are around, the mixers are talking, you don't make a sound because, and I think it was more about music setups. I'm not exactly sure, but I think I took it to an extreme and I just sat in the back and was terrified. I wouldn't sit down, wouldn't say anything, wouldn't talk to anybody. People would go through the whole day like, who's this guy? Who's this guy back here? And so I kind of pushed it to the extreme of being quiet, so nobody ever even knew who I was for a while. But I think one of the mistakes that people starting out do is they want to impress people so badly that they want to tell them what they know. And, if I've just met you and we're working and I'm trying to get through stuff and you come up and start telling me all these things, I'm like, the first thing I know is you don't have the experience yet. I'm trying to be no BS here. I was like, I don't really hear what you're saying yet. I mean, what I'm trying to get at is don't tell me what you know yet. Show me. Do it. Do it quietly, do it respectfully, do it on your own time. Show me that you've got the drive to do it on your own. Don't come up and tell me what you can do or what you're gonna do and all this stuff. Show me. Well, I've got a great example of this guy he's an assistant on our shows now, and he sort of epitomizes the personality that you like. Now, one of the best things I think you can do, it's not even about skill set sometimes, it's about being the person that people want to be around. You might be the best engineer in the world, but if you're a prick to be around, nobody's going to want to hire you and keep you around, so that'll push you away. You've got to try to be a person that people want to have around you. We had this guy, his name is Rowan Watson, and the Foley team from Australia was coming over and they were looking for a new assistant to help them. and they were looking through all these people. People would come in and rotate in and go in the Foley room, and they picked him out of everybody because they said he was the first one that didn't suggest a prop to use to the Foley artist, because this Foley artist has been doing it for 20 years. Everybody else would come in and go like, oh, what about this scene? Why don't you use this bottle? You know, and the Foley artist doesn't want to be told what to use by an assistant. And this guy was the first one that didn't suggest anything. He just sat back and watched. And they said he was the right kind of quiet, which I thought was a really interesting way to describe somebody. He was respectful, but not in a reclusive sort of way. Right. You know, so
I guess that's... Let me pick up on that, David, really quick here. Sorry, yeah. But, you know, you have to remember, if you're with us being mixers, you know, you come into a dub stage, it's treated like a product. It's like they're on the set. You know, a lot of filmmakers still treat that like they're shooting something, so you have to understand you're on a film set. And if you've been invited into that place, vetted by me or Gary, somebody that's brought you there, most people, they don't walk in the room and look around and think, oh, well, why is that guy there? I've never seen him. They go, this is somebody that's there. And obviously, you don't want to start, you know, the right kind of quiet is important. And one of the things that I've found out with anybody new that I work with is, and anybody today is, you know, I make 125 films. I don't give my opinion when I start with a new client until I'm asked. I kind of do the work. I let the work speak for itself. They come to you, and then they start really, I mean, they value your opinion anyways because they're letting you mix their movie. But I found more and more times that once they understand you're competent and stuff, they'll start then asking, and what is your opinion? What do you think of this music cue? And what do you do there? And I found that with interns or people that come in and visit the stage that invariably, and some filmmakers aren't nice, they're, you know, just like there's nice people everywhere, but it's right, David, it's the right kind of quiet, and it's the right kind of quiet, and then also understanding, though, that people understand that you have a right to be there because you've been asked to be in that environment. If we've asked you to come in, you're there for a reason because you have something to add.
What I would add to that is be aware of your surroundings. Yes, you're coming into that environment with an education, you have some technical knowledge about what is going on, but you are the right kind of quiet in the room. Be aware of the things, and I'm not just saying about the mix or of the console or what's going on. I mean, it's part of it, but not all of it. Be aware of what's going on so that you can be part of a solution before a problem becomes a problem. And it could be as simple as that director loves the celery and the celery is about to disappear because he's eaten it all. Maybe your spot then is to say, hey, where can I get some more celery for the stage? At the same time, if you know, because you see out of the corner of your eye that the automation computer is getting backlog or is beginning to crash or something, you can at least alert somebody that can be helpful to remedy a circumstance before it becomes a real problem. I would say be the right kind of quiet and be part of the bomb squad. Don't be part of the bomb.
I want to add something else. Are you done?
Yeah.
When I graduated and went to EFX, I was taken on as an intern, and I expected there to be a regimented program. Like, this is their internship. This is what they do with people. They shuttle them here. They shuttle them there. This is how they train their interns. I thought there was a program for this. I showed up the first day.
Right.
No. I showed up the first day. I'm like, okay, what do I do? And they're like, They tried to figure out which room I would be the least annoying in, and they just sent me there all day.
That's right. They stuck me with you.
So, you know, and this went on for a week or so. I'd show up every day, and I'd be like, what do I do? 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 You know, I was hungry. I wanted to know. Where am I going? There was no plan. There was no internship. I mean, there was basically, this is your, we opened the door to you. What else do you want? You know, that's what it was, really. That we've opened the door. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do?
Right.
So I sort of realized then, I've got to make, this is my internship, not their internship. This is mine. So from that day on, I didn't tell them I was doing this, but what I set out to do was like, I'm going to make myself indispensable because I worked 5 months. You had a 3 month. They paid you after 3 months?
I didn't get paid.
It was 5 months before I got a paycheck. But I set out to do these tasks that I thought, you know, this is going to help me. This is a job they normally pay people to do. I'm doing this for free.
Right.
And I did it and did it and did it and did it. And I knew it. One day I just realized, somebody's got to do this. They're relying on me to do it. I'm an employee here. I'm an unpaid employee that they need. And I felt like I'd finally crossed that threshold. I knew I was indispensable. I called him one morning and I said, I'm not coming in anymore until I'm getting paid. And they said, okay, come on in. So that was it. But you've got to take the bull by the horns and make it work. You got to make yourself indispensable.
I mean, I think we all had, I mean, being at EFX, I think we all had that moment too where it was, you said the first week I came in and I specifically remember there was that whole thing of like, Harry turned to me one day and said, okay, I'll see you tomorrow. And it was like, and Harry kind of started expecting me to be there and be the guy. And then after a couple weeks, you kind of go, oh, I'll be here. You know, you kind of, and you'll figure it out. You all have that moment of like, I belong here. And if you don't, then maybe it's not the right place for you or maybe it's not the right job. But yeah, you, it's hard.
As far as David being indispensable, when I started, it wasn't EFX, it was now Wilshire Stages, but a lot of the same people moved over. And I met David through Anne Schiavelli, who's a sound designer. On her instant message account, I would speak to David because he wrote a program that allowed us to search sound effects and audition them. And before that, you would have CD libraries or DAT libraries, and there would be paper that you would like go through in big books, and he made it to where you could search for door, and then there's were the doors that we had in the library, and you could click on them. And then there was the extra bit of fun was you could import it directly into Pro Tools. You could just go. And then he started selling it. I bought a copy of it. That's the first time we actually met in person. He's like, do you want your money back? No. But it was great. That's a great thing. If you didn't make that, I mean, not just hours, days, probably weeks of time editors spent figuring out what sound they were going to get to because you got them to that sound faster. So I think it's a great example of that was database programming from an audio engineer. And there's so many classes that I think we all go through that we're like, I don't think any of this is going to matter to me at all. And but I think it does. And I think having that drive and just being like multi-talented, amazing guys such as yourself as far as creating these things that fill needs is so much more than editing, so much more than design. Just want to say you're awesome, really. I don't know where else to go with that. But. When did you feel like you finally made it? Yeah. And you're probably all going to say because they're bashful
I don't think I have.
Not yet.
But that you really felt that you belonged. Like now I'm here. This is me. This is my industry. It's just I'm not getting into it. I'm there. Because everybody out here, including me, you guys have all made it.
I went through, I think there's an arc. I think there's an arc to your professional life. Going through EFX, I had a fairly quick-paced rise, I suppose you'd call it. Because I did a job at Soundstorm, and I'd only been editing like 2 years or something like that. And I had a job at Soundstorm, and I was editing. And the guy that was assisting had been an assistant for like 15 years. And I'm thinking, how am I editing and you're an assistant still? Because these other places, there was a totally different path about how long it takes you to get there. And I realized at that moment what a special place EFX was. But I started doing some work at Skywalker. My point is I had a fast rise. I've started doing some fairly decent sized shows at Skywalker and other places, and I started to think I was better than I was, you know, too soon. I think I really rose too soon, and I got kind of cocky there for a while. I really thought I was it, you know. I thought I was the dude, you know, and I realized over time that hadn't happened for me yet. I wasn't that guy yet, you know. Mark was bore witness to my attitude once
terrible,
or twice.
Everybody.
But so, and I see this happen a lot with people that come out of and start working, and it seems to happen about 5 years into the cycle. I seem to see people go through a hump of being really cocky and thinking that the industry is gonna go away if they suddenly disappear that day. But the more you work, the more you realize, wait a minute, there's some other really talented people out here, and I've got to keep my game up to stay afloat. So I had that moment early, but it wasn't real, you know, and then it dipped, and my confidence dipped, and I realized that I had a long way to go still. And I think it's important to keep that retrospective going on yourself. Keep your ego in check, because it will get a hold of you. And then you let your work prove.
I think you're right. It's all metrics. Like, I can't say, Mike, that it's. I think you have successes, and I think one thing that's really important to learn too is that this is a, you know, for me at least, it was a life. This was going to be my life, and so I know I'm going to do this for another 20, 25 years. And so you set goals, and sometimes they're financial, and sometimes it's about this, or you want to try. I'd really like to work on this film or with this filmmaker, and you set those metrics. And I think you have those moments where you hit a goal, and you have those moments where you have bad things happen on a film, and the director's not happy, or the studio's not happy, and you have all those things. And you know, Mike, I find it's been moments for me. You know, you win an Emmy, and I was like, it was a really flattering, nice thing. And then you always look back at the last 10 years. And as soon as you mentioned it, I thought just of a really nice thing that happened to me a couple weeks ago. As I was walking off the stage, we were going to lunch, and this guy in front of me kind of turned around, and he goes, "Mark," and I go, "Yeah," and he goes, "Doug," and I actually didn't know who he was at the time, and he goes. This guy goes, "Oh, I'm a really big fan," and I literally said, "Well, that's really creepy," and I said, "Oh, well, thank you," and he said, "Yeah, I really love your work," and I said, "Okay, thanks," and then he walked off, and I found out it was another mixer in the company I just started working for that worked there that I'd never met, and once again, that was like a moment where I was like, oh, that's a really nice thing to have another mixer just turn around and go, "Oh, I'm a really big fan of your work," and that was just a metric of this long thing that's going to be 30, 40 years in the business, and those sometimes it's a person you meet, and it's all that stuff, so... I can't say it was like a snap thing. It's just all these things of the first time I saw screen credit, the first time I was on a dub stage as a recordist, and I made it through the thing, and we did a print master, so.
And you hadn't been fired.
Fired, yeah.
Yeah, I kind of knew what I wanted to do early on. I think I'm a little bit different from a lot of other people in my graduating class. I knew going into my program what I wanted to do. So there was a sense of, I belong in that environment. I just have to find my way to that environment. But at the same time, once I worked my way onto the dub stage and got myself into the environment that I really wanted to work in, I've never taken that for granted. Whether I was an assistant or whether I was mixing or in whatever capacity that I was on that stage, I am lucky to be there. Mm-hmm. And I carry that today. But yeah, there are little successes along the way. It felt as good the day that Pat told me, your internship is done and we're gonna hire you for, you know, minimum wage at the time. That day felt as huge to me as the day I was told that Incredibles had been nominated for an Academy Award. It was the same emotion, the same level of success for me. And I don't take any of that for granted, any of it.
How about you, Frank?
Man, I just try to enjoy the ride at this point, especially, I mean, you know, getting to spend time with guys like this. Your question about, you know, making it, that I got paid to do what I love and I can put food on the table for the kids, have, you know, pay my mortgage so, you know, my wife and kids and I have a place to be. To me, that is more making it than anything else. There's a lot of people out there that would really like to do what we do, and we get to do it, you know, and live
you know, because of it, we get to live our life and pay our bills. So I think that's pretty successful, you know, for anyone.
I agree. I was just in LA last week, and on Valentine's Day, I have the best wife in the world. I was like, can I go to a studio with you on Valentine's Day to go geek out on gear? Nice. She's like, yes. So I'm in there at Sonic Magic. I'm with Jonathan Wales, who's the owner. And I walk into the main room, and he's like, this is transfer. And there's two interns that worked for us on the dub stage, Natasha and Kevin. Kevin now is going to work for Mark at Technicolor. And we're walking around the rooms, and we're going into different rooms and open the door, and there's, you know, Kyle and Jimmy, who are two other Full Sail grads and interns of mine. We'd go into another room, more interns of mine, and we all sat together and had lunch. And what was amazing to me is they're all eating lunch, they're all talking like editors, they're all talking about the show that they're doing, the problems, the short schedules, and how are we gonna make it work. And there was another intern that was walking back and forth frantically, Jeff Roy. Hey, how you doing? We have an ISDN session with New York. Good to see you. Just run back in. And that, for me, was like, that's the most fantastic thing ever. And I'm sitting there with my wife, and I was like, these are all guys that worked their butts off at school. They came in, they did the internship, and they've made it. Their very first job, but you could see it in just everything that they did, that they absolutely made it. We're almost at the very last minute, so... I wanted to give each of you an opportunity of say whatever you'd like to say to our students, to our online students, whether it be advice, encouragement. What are your last words? We'll start with Mark. And we'll...
Oh, don't do that.
We'll never get a chance.
No, I mean,
thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
Tell us a story, Mark.
No, these guys know I tell stories. They go on for hours. No, I mean, I think the biggest thing that I've always just really harp on is that if you really have the passion, you really have to believe that you belong there, and you can, you know, one of the things, and Mike touched on it earlier, is I think it's always really important. The goals are important, and if you set the goal, you can work backwards and figure out the things you need to do and the steps you need to take. And sometimes it is just making that phone call and all that stuff, and then readjust, and also go out. You know, Gary comes down to Burbank probably two or three times a year, and I get to see him, and we have these dinners, and it's the nicest thing, and it's nice that I feel like I have a support system in the community too. You know, Mike, you say, how do you know you made it and stuff, but Gary and I talk about, oh, Gary, what do you think I should do here, and what did you do, and Gary says this, and he tells me what I'm doing wrong, I tell him what he's doing wrong, which is nothing. But to have people you bounce off of and to have friends and understand that you don't have to do it alone, because it really is a community, and I think that's the most just important thing. Just be encouraged and make sure you encourage other people too. It is a very cutthroat business, but I can tell you without a doubt, I've met some people that didn't treat each other well, but it's really hard to get kicked out of the post-production business. It's a very big community, and we have some redheaded stepchilds that you still see around after, you know, I've been doing this almost 25 years now, and so it's a community, and just make, you know, when you become a part of it, embrace that part of it.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, I said earlier on the panel to listen to each other, listen to the people around you, listen to music, listen to movies, just listen and absorb and process and figure out what you like, because that will help develop your sense of taste. Find a hero, find an icon, find somebody whose work you really respect and hang on to that, study that, and let that inspire you to further your craft and your vision for whatever it is that you want to do. Oh, go with that.
I had something really cool pop in my mind when Mark was talking, and it's gone. So instead, I will say this. The bad news is there's a lot of talented people that never really get a shot at making it work. The good news is, and Mark sort of mentioned this, there's some people doing this at a fairly high level that really shouldn't be doing it. I'm probably one of them. What I'm getting at is there is room for you. The opportunity is there. I think we touched on, I'm very impressed with everybody's answer today. You know, I think you just gotta practice and stick to it. I hate for these things to sound like BS answers because they sound like cookie cutter answers, you know, but if the phone, if nobody picks up or they say, we don't have a place for you, that just means that day, tomorrow, situation might be different. You don't want to bug somebody to death, you don't want to be annoying, but keep calling. You know, if you find a place you want to be, keep calling, because that's, you know how I got the job on Lord of the Rings? I was working at Skywalker, I was cutting some commercials in this back room, and they basically kicked me out, so we don't have anything for you anymore. I went by Chris Boys' room to say bye, I'm leaving today. And he's like, I got this movie that I can't do, it's called Lord of the Rings, would you be interested in that? And I was like, I tried to play it down because I didn't want him to see how excited I was, like, and him go, oh, maybe I should take it instead. But that's how it happened. I happened to go by his room one day, and we had a relationship anyway, so I don't know, it may have happened anyway, but that's how the thing happened. So look for the opportunities and make the opportunities.
I would say, number one, network with everybody that is here, or if you're online, the people that are in your class. And I'm not talking about just in your program. If you're in audio, network with people in film and video, people in game design and all that. They could be your clients, or they could hire you. And at the same time, while you're doing that, learn a little bit about what they do so that you can communicate with them. You know, if you have a basic understanding of the language of an editor, it will help you, you know, with if you're doing audio post or whatever. You know, same with, and I'm not saying you need to learn how to, you know, run Maya or anything like that, but if you can communicate with an animator and take full advantage of the staff here. You guys have an amazing opportunity with not only your course directors and the program managers and stuff like that, but the career development department. They're really awesome people that they're here for you. That's their whole job, is to help you. So don't miss out on it.
That's right. Can I just, sure, one more? I mean, that's all I'm going to do is basically paraphrase what he said, but the type of student you are now is the type of worker you will be. So if you're skating through Full Sail, you're going to try to skate through when you get out. So don't skate. You know, work, be an excellent student, because then you're going to be an excellent worker.
And do remember, too, I talked to a lot of the instructors, and I think one of the things is when you're a student and then you have instructors and you're in a class with for 2 weeks or 4 weeks or 6 weeks, sometimes you might just think, like, I don't really give a crap about time code because it's not important. And then Gary Rizzo comes to your class and goes, you need to know about time code. And every time that he goes, I need to do this. But remember, your instructors are pretty smart, and they have, you know, we learned all we needed to from them. And really do take advantage of that, because it doesn't need to be a panelist that tells you what something, but the fundamentals are very important.
And this is the hardest part when you get these guys together, is that it always has to come to an end. It's very sad that it is, but I want to thank you guys all for attending the session today. More importantly, I'd like to thank Frank, David, Gary, and Mark for their knowledge and valuable information.